Hi, I'm Andrea Tomas. I'm professor of electrical and computer engineering at the University of Texas at Austin, and I'm CEO and co-founder of Diligent Robotics. I'm excited to have the opportunity to talk to you today about one of my passions, building teams of humans and robots. At UT Austin, my lab is called the Socially Intelligent Machines Lab, and here are some of the awesome students and robots I've been working with for the past 12 years. Our research is focused on building machines where the human and the robot can be in the same space, working together, making use of the same objects, and performing actions in socially appropriate ways. So looking around the workspace in a way that makes sense and moving around the workspace in a way that makes sense. Over more than 10 years, our robots have interacted with hundreds and hundreds of people in lab studies. And making robots that end users find natural to interact with and collaborate with is really a key to our research. Our goal is for robots to be like a team member, lending a helping hand, so not like a tool that you have to think about how to operate or, you know, to have to remember how to interact with, but really like a teammate that just makes sense in the same workspace. For example, take a look at this team of people. This is a thought experiment that I really like. So this is an ad hoc team that came together one morning, working together on a disaster relief team to build some temporary furniture. And if you put yourself in the shoes of one of these people here, I'm sure you can imagine easily jumping into this team saying, "Hey, how can I help?" And someone would really quickly show you what they were doing and how you could help. But this kind of collaborative social teamwork is a computationally hard problem if a robot's going to help out. And so this is really interesting to think about some of the challenges that we have in human-robot interaction. So the robot has to perceive all of the human's multimodal behavior. So this is a hard computer vision problem. And then the robot has to control the timing of coordinated joint actions with people. So that's a hard planning problem. And then if we're going to generate a lot of the ways that you coordinate joint action is really through dialogue and being able to generate multimodal embodied dialogue. So that's an interesting and hard natural language problem. And if we need to learn new actions, like we were talking about in this ad hoc team, then we need to be able to add new tasks to the robot's skill set on the job. And so that's a hard machine learning problem. And by the way, all this has to happen in real time, which creates its own real computational challenges. So these are the fascinating reasons why I've devoted my career to human-robot interaction. And I actually think these are some of the hardest and most important problems in robotics that are going to have the biggest impact once we solve them.
The piece of this problem that my lab has been focused a lot on is the learning from humans piece. We like to take the problem of learning from demonstration and think about how this can be truly a social dialogue between a machine learning algorithm and the human teacher. So let's take a look at a canonical example.
Start here. Okay. Go here. All right. Go here. Yes. End here. That was demo number 3.
So you can see we think a lot about how the just giving the information to the machine, giving the demonstration, giving the data is going to be a natural social interaction for the person and what kind of feedback the robot can give during that process to ensure that people understand that the information has been received. The other important algorithmic approach we take is thinking about separating out the action from the goal. So what we've seen a lot over and over is that people are very good at demonstrating goals, so we want to take advantage of that. In this case, the robot models the goal as a visual change that's happening to this box to make it go from open to closed. So then after the robot has a model, even a preliminary one, you can think about what happens during playback and during execution between the human and the robot.
Answer. How did I do?
That was a success.
All right.
So here is a great example of how people are both an input giving data to the robot to learn new things, but also kind of that ongoing feedback of how am I doing and am I on the right track? So that was a success. But if it was unsuccessful, then, you know, maybe time to practice. So what's interesting about that example is that the robot has a good enough model of the goal already to be able to self-supervise and say, you know, I did this, I made a modification to my action plan, I think it was successful, I think this was unsuccessful, and that's what really allows the robot to build a robust model. And in the end, in this particular work, we were able to see that the robot could get from 0% success on its action plans seeded from a human demonstration to 100%, all by taking the goal that the person had demonstrated and using that to kind of self-supervise the action that they had actually demonstrated. So really picking the best of what people can give and optimizing that. Recently, we've taken this further, using simulations and simulators to do that practice. It makes a lot of sense to not have to kind of patiently wait for the robot to do things. We can take a single demonstration from a person and then use that to seed a simulated model of a task or a situation. And then we can tune those model parameters in simulation over and over and over until the simulator is in line with what the real world goal wants to be. And then after simulated practice, the model can now attempt some desired goal in the real world. And we can achieve those results a lot faster than the physical practice. So this is a great example of a human-robot team where people are good at giving that initial demonstration of the situation, they're good at demonstrating what the goal is, and then robots are really good at optimizing for that goal. Now, the subtitle of my talk is From Theory to Practice, so I do want to switch gears now and tell you about the human-robot teams that I'm most excited about today, and that's the ones that we're building at Diligent Robotics. Welcome to Diligent Robotics, headquartered here in Austin, Texas, where I've been spending the last 3 years as CEO and co-founder of Diligent. My co-founder Vivian Chu and I have been really excited to take some of that human-robot interaction research and really put it to practice. Our mission here at Diligent is to build robots that help people. This is our first robot, Moxie. And Moxie is designed to work side by side with clinical staff in hospitals. And we are out with hospitals today working, Moxie's working side by side with nurses and clinicians, taking on some of the kind of mundane routine tasks and activities that take up their time. And we're just really excited to see all of the ways that Moxie is truly being a teammate to nursing staff and really helping clinicians in this important time. Today at Diligent, we're live in multiple sites within the HCA healthcare system, and we have a world-class team of robotics experts here in Austin, Texas. And one thing I'm really proud of is the human-centered approach that we've taken with our product. We spent thousands of hours in R&D phase of our company iterating on what it is that nurses actually need help with and how automation can really fit into their day-to-day workflow. So I can show a little demo video here of some of the R&D that we did in the field. We iterated on lots of different ways that the robot might transport items, what items are most needed, lots of observations of nursing workflows, and have been working out all of the manipulation skills and constraints that are going to be needed to handle all of the different variety of items. where's the right place to drop things off and how to carry them. We learned a lot about the size and constraints of storage that might be needed on the robot and how nurses are really going to be able to use that most effectively. Social navigation is a huge importance in this environment. You know, clinicians are busy and we really want to make sure that the robot is not getting in their way. So a lot of what we think about with our navigation stack is how to be socially appropriate and not getting in people's way. We experimented with lots of different tasks, some that are very interactive with the end user, where the human is doing one part of the task and then the robot's doing the other. And even though the robot was designed for nursing support, we saw so much enthusiasm from patients and people wanting to see the robot and excited to see the robot out in the hall. A big part of the R&D was really around identifying the things that Moxie can do autonomously and asynchronously to support nursing, because we know that that's going to be a huge part of how the robot's really providing its true value to the customer and end users. And this focus on designing for the complete human-robot interaction has really been what makes the difference for our customers. And the feedback we're seeing from nursing staff is just overwhelmingly positive, with people talking about Moxie being part of the team, which to me is the ultimate success metric. This pandemic that we're currently facing has really brought to the forefront how incredibly stretched our hospital systems are. And with Moxie, we're working with hospitals to help them better define workflows and build better operations for their hospitals, having people focused on patient care and clinical decisions and using their expertise, and have robots focused on the routine kind of fetch and deliver activities that can support that work. I think one of the most interesting things I've learned about getting robots to work in the real world is the millions of little things that we just do not have to worry about in the research lab, but then become a make or break feature in the real world. Like something as simple as battery life or uptime of the robot. In the research lab, it just isn't a big deal if you have to restart the robot fresh every time you do a new experiment. But that's just not a luxury that you have in the real world. Then I think my other big takeaway from putting robots into hospitals and having them interact with nurses every day is that a big part of what we're doing, and I think this goes for all service robot companies out there today, is we're educating the public about robots. People do not know what robots are supposed to do. And in our experience, people's expectations are either way too high or way too low for what the robot's really going to be able to do. But what we see is that when you're truly providing value and the robot's filling a real need, the people in the environment are ready to meet you halfway and to put in the effort to learn. I think a great example is when you think about other new services like Uber or Instacart. Like, most people have had a failure, like the driver shows up in the wrong place, or you got one banana instead of a bunch of bananas. And the service is so useful, though, that you put the work in to understand how to use it better. And I think this is where we're going to be at with service robots for a little while. And as a society, we're still kind of figuring out how they're supposed to fit into these human robot teams and what that's really going to look like. And this is a period where, as we're figuring it out, this period is going to be where getting the human-robot interaction right is going to really make all the difference. So I'm excited for you to see all the great human-robot interaction research at IROS 2020. Enjoy.